morning, Green Valley. Who's happy to be in church today? So am I, man. I'm so glad to be here today. And you've got all three of us today. Now, here's the problem. The problem is there's three pastors here, and you know how long we talk. So this service is going to be about 3 hours, okay? So just sit tight, and we got food coming in and the whole thing. We're going to enjoy ourselves. Hey, before we get going, we got to celebrate something at junior high camp this last week. And so some of you don't know, we always do a Bible theme throughout this series of camp, throughout the day. So it happened at kids camp, happens at junior high camp. Make sure that we bring the gospel just as well as we bring fun to them. But 14 junior hires raised their hand to accept Jesus as their Savior this week. That's fantastic. Fantastic. So today what we're doing is we're going to look back at what we've been doing for the last 9 weeks, talking about the early church. We're going to reflect a little bit on what they did. And today we're going to take away, hey, how does this apply to us going on in the future? And where we're going to start today was the word innovation. Now, what's interesting is that anything that changes or progresses have had to innovate over the years. And so, think about the last 100 years. What are some of the innovations that have kind of changed society?
Well, just right off the top of my head, I think things like when you think about flight, airplanes over the last 100 years of being able to actually travel that way. A couple other ones are amazing when you think about television. Computers, technology changed so much. Think about the advent of computers. And
one of my favorite innovations is the GPS system in my car.
Where would we be without GPS? We'd all be lost. That's where we'd be.
Who remembers MapQuest and all of the 52 point-by-point directions and printing it all off, right? I mean, for you younger ones, it was a rough time for us.
Anyone still use a paper map? Anybody still do maps? Quite a few of them.
So, awesome. So real quick, because it's the morning crowd. This isn't even in our notes, but we were going to L.A., and this is way back, Kelly and I, while we were dating. We were in L.A., we meet some people down there. And I had to pull off the side of the road to get a paper map out and put it on the top of my car. I could not find where we were going. I crumpled it up, threw it down, stomped around, and probably said a couple adjectives that I needed to repent for afterwards. But so glad for GPS. I wouldn't find my way here every week.
Or folding up one of the old maps. You ever try to refold it?
It never worked. It never worked. It never goes back into it. Anyway, but there's also some things you haven't thought about that are innovations that are awesome. So how about this one right here? This has been an innovation that has changed the world right here. You can use it for anything. It's duct tape. Yeah. How many know duct tape is an amazing innovation? Yeah, use it for anything, right?
Recently I was somewhere, I can't even remember where it was, but somebody needed stitches. I mean, it was clearly a wound that needed stitches, and they used duct tape to close it up.
It doesn't.
Yeah.
Well, Kelly and I were driving back from someplace, I forget, this last week, and there was a car that was put together by duct tape. The fender was falling off. The window had to be duct tape. It was pretty amazing. How about this one? This one you probably don't think of, but this is an innovation. Post-it notes. Anybody use post-it notes here? How many of you? See? Yeah. See? Yeah, they're a big deal, man. Yeah. Or how about this one? TV dinners. TV dinners right here. Anybody remember TV dinners? Okay,
anybody
now here's the thing.
To forget them?
Nobody looked like that eating TV dinners. They looked more like this. This is what they looked like when they had TV dinners right here. How about this one right here? This is huge. This is huge. It's the Snuggie. Anybody got a Snuggie? I literally have a Raider Snuggie. I literally have that. And then the last one is my favorite. And John, I'm just going to let you take this one, okay?
Yeah, the last one. Anybody ever grow a chia pet? when my hair gets longer, it's like a chia pet. So this is an image of me, right?
It does. It grows this way.
It goes sideways. Yeah. Right? It doesn't get long. It goes sideways.
So with all that fun stuff, let me ask the question today is why did the early church have to innovate in order to get the gospel spread throughout the world?
Yeah, I think we need to just remember the time that Jesus came to the earth in. If you look back at that time, it was such a cruel time. It was a time of a lot of conquests, battles being fought, and people, you know, overtaking other nations, and power really being used in ways to exploit and oppress people. And just to remind us all of this beautiful scripture that says why Jesus came to the earth. In John 3:16 and 17, it says, "For God so loved the world that he sent his only son, so that whoever believed in him would not perish but have eternal life." And he didn't send his son into the world to condemn the world, right? But to save the world. And so if we think about the early church, their task was that they were to bear witness to who Jesus was. They were then to be the bringers of the gospel, and they were going to push forward the mission of Jesus to redeem a broken and a dark and a pain-filled, sin-filled world. And if they're going to do it, they've got to live in the way that Jesus lived, which was not to condemn the world, but to offer the good news of who Jesus is so that the world could be saved. And so in the face of a time that was full of cruelty and full of darkness, the innovations that the early church had to take on had to look like goodness, had to look like light, had to look like forgiveness and redemption. They had to hold power in a different way, or they had to have a different kind of power. And we spent a lot of weeks talking about the power of the Holy Spirit, right? That is not a power that we have on our own as human beings. It's not a human kind of power. It is a supernatural kind of power that comes from God. And then the church got to be innovative in living into this self-giving faithfulness that Jesus had modeled for them while he walked the earth. And all of this looked so contrary to the way that the world looked at the time that Jesus came. And so to be innovative was to live into that truth of who God had created the church to be and was calling the church to be. And we live in that same tension today. We have got to be people that live by a different power than the world does. We have got to be a people that live different kinds of lives, that live this self-sacrificial, giving, faithful life that God has called us to.
Yeah, I heard one person describe it. It was a pastor that I really respect. He described it, you know, we have people in our culture that live in this freeway. And so there's the fast lane, there's the middle lane, there's all different kinds of way to describe that. But as Christ followers, we think that we're going the opposite direction of the world. We're not even going the opposite direction of the world. We live in a completely different freeway. We're on a completely different freeway. We live as citizens of the kingdom of God. And so in order to make sure the kingdom of God reigns or is seen by the world, our lives have to be ones that shine Christ. So the question today is this. This is the question. What can we learn from the early church about innovating, which we can apply to our church right now today?
Yeah, and I think it's important to know before we jump into that in terms of defining what gospel innovation actually is, because there's two things that we have to sort of be clear on, and that is message and method. And what's important is when gospel innovation is the message never changes. It's the same. The writer of Hebrews says that Jesus Christ was the same before, today, and for eternity. And Peter was talking about this in Acts 4 when we shared through the message about him giving sort of the gospel message. He says there is salvation in no one else. There's no other name in heaven, under heaven, by which we are saved. So the message never changes when it comes to gospel innovation, but the method sometimes has to change, and it has to face new challenges and new opportunities as well. And what we learned from the early church is how, though the message never changes, the way it gets delivered does change. Couple things that we learned in the book of Acts. If you think about the house church, you think about persecution and the starting of the house church, and why it started was because of dispersion and persecution, where people could not gather publicly. And so they were looking at opportunities to continue to innovate, to be able to same message, but to gather together in terms of sharing the gospel and growing in their faith together. I think the written word is another great example of that in terms of innovation, in terms of, you know, before it was like oral traditions where stories passed down, and then the written word comes around, and there's new ways to actually read and discuss faith through writing. I mean, think about Paul's letters. This is all written word in terms of how the gospel sort of perpetuated into the world. I think about it today with innovations. You know, think about texting in terms of innovations. I get almost daily from a group of people scriptures texted to me. And you think about that sort of innovation, it is a new way of communication. And so we've learned from the early church in terms of what we can apply is that the message stays the same, but the way that it's delivered, the methods that by which it reaches people are completely different. And I'll say this, if a church does not innovate, it becomes irrelevant. If a church stops innovating in terms of getting the gospel message out there in new ways to reach people, it becomes irrelevant. I lived in Europe for a couple of years, work-related stuff, and I traveled through Europe. And it's amazing when you go through a lot of different places of seeing these amazing churches that were erected 1,000 years ago. The architecture was phenomenal in these churches. So you go there and you're just blown away by these beautiful churches. But the sad part is for so many of them is that's all they are, is almost relics. Because the gospel did not innovate and more people started to sort of disconnect because though the message is there, the methods by which it reached people stopped. And it's so important for us to understand in facing those challenges that the gospel has to continue to innovate. And I think that's what we learned from the early church.
Absolutely. So in our day, you know, the early church faced different kinds of challenges. We have different kinds of challenges. So what are some of the things, Bekah, the goal of the early church? It's the same as ours. We have the same goals, and that's to spread the gospel. But what are the different challenges and emphasis? Like pretty much everything revolves around worldly culture and interest, but they had different emphasis that they had challenges then to what we have now.
Right. So one of the most significant needs that the early church was facing in the world was spiritual blindness. It says in Acts 4:2 that these leaders were very disturbed that Peter and John were teaching the people that through Jesus there is a resurrection of the dead. And it's important that we remember that these are the people who were literally walking the face of the earth the same time that Jesus was, and they could not see him as the Messiah. Then Jesus dies on the cross and he's resurrected after 3 days. They still cannot see him as the Messiah. And then the apostles and the disciples are proclaiming the resurrection of Jesus and they still cannot see Jesus as the Messiah. So there's just a very, very, well-developed over many centuries of time, spiritual blindness among these people that the apostles are trying to preach the good news of who Jesus is and call them into the light so that they can see the truth of who God is. And it's the same for us today. And so today we want to talk about three main spiritual blinders in our world, in our culture specifically. And they are hedonism, they are loneliness, and then skepticism. And so first of all, hedonism, what is that? Well, it's essentially, it says this, that pleasure is the highest good and proper aim of human life. Do you guys recognize that in our culture today, in the lives that we are told that we need to live? And the problem with the time that we are living in today is that we have everything, and yet we have nothing. Because the things that oftentimes we are pursuing or that our culture puts in front of us to pursue or even kind of calls us into or tries to entice us with wind up being really empty, right? We get all these messages all day long about pleasure and enjoy this and do this and have this for yourself, and we still feel empty.
And the real deceptive part of that is that a lot of the things that hedonism falls under are not necessarily bad. So is it bad for you to go to the lake and have fun? No, that's not bad. Is it bad for you to play softball? Is it bad for you to play cornhole? No, those things aren't bad. The problem is when those are sought to fill an inner spiritual need is what leaves us empty. And that's actually with all the junk that we have that is contrary to the life that God wants us to live in our American culture, we have all this side to deal with too, because there's a lot of fun, good things that we try to replace God with, and it just leaves us empty.
and it leaves us frazzled, right? I mean, anybody running around feeling frazzled these days, or feeling overwhelmed, or we have this kind of this sense of FOMO, like I'm gonna miss out on something, right? We have this 24-hour access to things on our phones or through the internet or through our televisions, and so we just constantly are told that we need to consume all of these things. And so, John, there's a quote from Anne Lemke, the paradox is that hedonism, the pursuit of pleasure for its own sake, leads to anhedonia, which is the inability to actually enjoy pleasure of any kind. So that's really cruel, actually, isn't it?
Yeah, you almost become anesthetized to the things you're pursuing as far as satisfaction. And, you know, psychologists have a term that they sort of evaluate this scenario with. It's called the hedonic treadmill, where people become get on literally this treadmill of trying to satisfy themselves with pleasures. Again, not that they're bad things per se, but when they become central things, that's what you pursue. And this hedonic treadmill that they talk about gets to this place where you're never satisfied. You actually, the things that you pursue as central things in your life or the main thing in your life, you never attain it. So it is like this idea that you're on this treadmill of more acquisition, more experience. I mean, addictions fall into that category in many different ways. And so you can look at this where all of a sudden you find yourself caught up in a culture where more, more, more is sort of a theme. And you get yourself into this place where you say, hey, I am just on this treadmill of sort of that I can't get off, in a sense. You know, somebody said it this way, which I love the way they talked about this. So we live in a culture that's addicted to speed. And it's that speed of everything coming at us instantaneously to get more. And all of a sudden, we find ourselves at times on this treadmill and that we don't even realize it.
And, you know, we don't try to predict us when Jesus is coming back, but this is what Paul said to Timothy about what it would look like in the last days. It said, for people will love themselves and their money. They will be boastful and proud, scoffing at God, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful. They will consider nothing sacred. They'll be unloving and unforgiving. They will slander others and have no self-control. They will be cruel and hate what is good. They will betray their friends, be reckless, be puffed up with pride, and love pleasure rather than God. And this is kind of what we're facing in our society, is we have a hedonistic society. And so as Christ followers, we got to combat that. The second thing that we have there is we have loneliness, right? Loneliness is a big deal. And when we talk about loneliness, it's emotional exclusion, people that are forgotten. And a lot of people in our day and age are not alone, but they are lonely because they don't have deep, authentic relationships. As a matter of fact, this is a Harvard study. It found that 43% of our young adults reported increases in loneliness since the outbreak of the pandemic, COVID. About half reported that no one in the past few weeks had taken more than just a few minutes to ask how they were doing in a way that made them feel like a person genuinely cared. So what's causing this loneliness? Well, sadly, some of our humankind's most recent innovations have created a society where we have the inability to go deep in relationships and have real deep, authentic relationships.
Yeah, so I recently was able to speak with our youth group on a Monday night and talked about our cell phones and how really this tool that was innovated and intended to help us connect has actually led to us feeling more disconnected than ever before. This thing that is meant to give us access to one another has actually isolated us more. And you guys, I have to tell you, it's really a concerning pandemic of loneliness amongst our young people, that this innovation is a key part to making happen in their lives. And here's the thing that I know about God. God did not create us for aloneness. God created us for connection and for community and for genuine relationship. And so what our children, what our young people, and us even as adults are unlearning is how to connect with other people in real and genuine conversation and relationship, because we're just firing off text to one another. You can't read the tone behind the text, or we're shooting off emails, or we're posting things on our Instagram or our Facebook feed that really isn't real life, right? So how in the world are we supposed to connect with one another if we're not even putting forth what our real life is like? And the internet and online life is so cruel. It is causing people to feel like they have to look a certain way or behave a certain way, and heightening people's sense of anxiety. Just they can't even be who they are because we're so cruel to one another online.
I heard one pastor say it this way, and I love this, is that when you're looking at social media, you're looking at everyone else's highlight reel and you're comparing it to your everyday. And that creates a lot of self-esteem issues.
Yeah. And we live in one of the most wealthy countries in the world. We have access to a lot of really good things. But this is what Mother Teresa said. She said, loneliness and the feeling of being unwanted is the most terrible poverty. And so just like the early church had to deal with spiritual blinders, and they had different challenges that they were facing, and a lot of it was centered around physical poverty, we are dealing with, in this day and age as a church, with some emotional poverty, and that is this epidemic of loneliness amongst our young people, and even if we were honest, us adults too.
Yeah, and that actually segues into the third one, which is skepticism is a new challenge. And I think some of that we just talked about with sort of social media and online is we live in a culture of skepticism because of what's real and what's not. And misinformation that comes and, you know, comes, whether it's a political agenda behind it or a marketing agenda or a greed agenda or negative programming, whether it's what's coming at us and how we filter things. So we've created a culture that we're trying to break through, where everything is scrutinized to an extreme, to an unhealthy level. So you look at people in relationships and you're always saying, can I trust this person? Is this person for my good, or is it something negative? And how I actually treat other people. So it creates this wall of, it keeps us from going deeper in our relationships, because there's always this, okay, what's the real story here? And what's your true motivations here? And so we have to ask ourselves, because we find in this sort of world or culture of skepticism that says, where are we getting our truth? Where are we finding what is actually real with everything that's not out there?
And facing today, it's been sad for me to see, you know, the church has earned its reputation a little bit for churches, for people not to trust. They've kind of earned that in some ways by falling. And just recently, we've had three prominent speakers, preachers, who have just had to step down from their ministries because it has created a lot of distrust that's going on. So here's the question I have. The question is this, this is what we're up against. So how do we find new ways to innovate? How do we bring the gospel up against these three things?
I like this quote from Theodore Levitt that says, creativity is thinking up new things, but innovation is doing new things. And so if we are facing kind of these three main spiritual blinders, we need to be doing new things. We need to be doing things differently. And really, I believe that the church has the message of the hope of Jesus Christ to share with the world. And specifically related to hedonism, here's what we believe. That hedonism, if it's the pursuit of pleasure, serving is the purveyor of purpose. And so the new way that the church gets to live into in the face of hedonism is actually serving. And so just in one way that we're doing that here at Green Valley is we're reimagining and redreaming our missions strategy. There was a way that we did missions before the pandemic and before things shut down. And now we are having to reimagine and redream and ask God for new direction for mission strategy in the here and now, in how the world is now and where the needs are now and where people are now. And it's really exciting to get to dream into those things, because serving is going to lead us into living into the purpose that God has for our life.
Yeah, and it broadens our horizons and perspective about God's sort of heart for the world. We have many different examples here in terms of how it's affecting some of our church family, and one in particular is some of our church family, Len and Tiffany Ramirez, who have been down to Mexico on the mission trip two different times. And they just both have a heart for God. They serve here. They're just amazing people in the community, but they hadn't really gotten to experience that bigger perspective of God's heart for the world. And so they went down to Mexico about a year ago, and then they just came with this most recent trip, and it has changed their perspective. And it's not that they didn't care before, it's just they become more aware of what's going on that is changing them here. And Len, for example, it's like they're talking about sort of like everything that's happening. They've connected with Dave Hessler down in Tijuana in terms of having conversations and how to support him from here. He had his 60th birthday a couple of months ago, which I always like to remind him he's older than me by a few months, so it's a good thing. But at his surprise party, what he wanted is he didn't want gifts. He wanted sort of funds and donations to go down to Dave and in Mexico. It just has given them a new perspective. And I think this is why we keep talking, and you mentioned it a couple of weeks ago. We want everybody to experience a mission trip, because not that you have to go on a mission trip, but it's to see what God's heart is in a global sense and not just a local sense, because it will make you different here as well.
Yeah, it does something to you, and it is a goal of ours. And maybe some of you can't go to Mexico, that's fine, but some of you could go to Common Ground on Saturday, which is our missions outreach to our community for people who are struggling. Because here's why. You know, you can watch something on TV, you can hear us talk about the stories, but unless you're present, it doesn't do what it does when you are actually there, when you can see it, smell it, feel it, touch it, be around it. It resets you. And this is going to be the struggle for all of us, is to reprioritize our time, because we got all kinds of stuff we want to do, stuff we have to do. But making sure that we reprioritize our life, that we're not living trying to satisfy with something that's going to lead us nowhere, but living our life that's going to lead to a purpose that brings satisfaction inwardly. And that's why this missions thing is so important to us. And so that means all of us, our society as well, has to reset its priorities. And resetting your priorities is super hard. As a matter of fact, over our lifetime, Kelly and I probably had a dozen times have had to sit down and have a talk and just go, okay, we got to switch things around because we've added too many things and we're going crazy. We have to reprioritize. It's not easy. But once you do, there's like this weight lifted off of you. Like you can see clearly and go, no. I that's good, but I'll get to that later. This is what's important. And this is what we see in the Bible, that every time that we see this in David's life, that he himself had to reset himself. Why? Because we all have limits. We have limited emotional ability, limited time, limited funds. We all have limits. And so what did he do to reset himself? He said, the Lord's my shepherd. I have all I need. He lets me rest in green meadows. He leads me beside peaceful streams. He renews my strength. You see this in the early church. Their priorities were set. And the priorities were that they were going to make sure that they had time to fellowship together. It was all over the Bible. Fellowship, all through the book of Acts. Fellowship together over meals. And I'm sure there's laughter and fun going on in there, but they're talking about God. They sat at the apostles' feet, or whoever was in charge at the time, the pastor, and they learned. They set those priorities and they served. It was a big deal back then to serve because they had so many needs. Those were the priorities. Did they do other stuff? Absolutely. They probably played cornhole. They probably had it back then. But those were the priorities that had to be set in order for them to have purpose in their life. So hitting on these things, John, how do we approach this loneliness thing?
Yeah, so loneliness, I love this statement that we came up with, but loneliness is the epidemic, but acceptance and invitation are the antidote. And here's the thing about the church. The church is either going to be an excluding body or it's going to be an accepting body. And I think there's three things that we have to hit really hard when it comes to new ways to deal with the loneliness out there. And the first one is that we have to maintain and be an invitational church. We have to take that to another level. And what I mean by invitational is that these doors are open for everyone. Now, let me be clear about this, is that we're not saying, when we say accepting and inviting, we're not saying affirming, meaning, hey, we just condone anything that goes in terms of lifestyle and how people live, because God calls us to a certain standard of obedience and direction and how to live. But we do not exclude anyone. This is really important that these doors are open, because as we know, we're all sitting here together and we have all kinds of different ideas and decisions we've made in life, ways we think of how to live life. There's a lot of differences here. But the one thing that binds us together is our love for Jesus Christ and Jesus Christ being the main thing in our lives. And so we want to protect and be an invitational church and take that to a whole nother level in this age where people are so disconnected and lonely. Second one is intention, is that we want to be intentional in addressing this loneliness. And what I mean by that is going deeper in our relationships, taking the time. It's not just, hey, come through these doors and, hey, good luck, figure it out. It's, hey, we want to do life together and be really, really intentional about how we do life together. It's easy to hang out with people for weeks and months and years and not really know what's going on in their life. And so we want to be intentional in investing to say, hey, doing time together and being physically together and hanging out is the only way you're going to deepen and have authentic relationships. And then the last one, of course, is just being an including church, is that no, again, it's sort of like the invitation that we want to come one, come all, but we want to be inclusive, not exclusive.
So one of the scriptures that talks about this, it says all the believers devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, to fellowship, and sharing in meals and to prayer. They worshiped together in the temple each day, met in homes for the Lord's Supper, and shared their meals with great joy and generosity, all the while praising God and enjoying the goodwill of all people. And each day the Lord added to their fellowship those who are being saved. And anyway, what I love about that is there's your priorities right
there.
That
says it all right there, right?
Now, there's a story that you have, because on this deep relationship thing, about a gentleman who reprioritized his life based on.
Yeah, so one of the things that we do around here that many of you know about is our Big Wednesdays, which is coming together where we do men's and women's Bible studies. We have different groups and classes, both from next gen all the way up. And one of the Bible studies that this last semester for men's Bible study, it's a gentleman that came to that. And, you talk about busyness and prioritizing. And this person that came and started doing life with us every week through this Bible study was really open up front that was, hey, this feels like something else I'm trying to add to my busy schedule as it is. So you could tell that coming in with, I need to do this, I want to do this, but it's like adding to the list. But what's amazing that started to happen over a few weeks is it quickly became clear that he realized of how much he needed this, that there was not only this connection with other men, but also there's really rest in that. It wasn't something he was adding to the busy schedule. It was actually him finding rest of where he needed to be at the center of God's will with a bunch of other people doing life together. So what happened was it shifted his priorities to where it started to shape everything else he was doing outside of coming together there, making that sort of the hub of how he started to reprioritize the rest of his life. Because what happens with purpose is when you find out your purpose in life, it starts to drive how you prioritize your life. And this is sort of what he started coming out of with this, is realizing that, hey, I one of the new ways to deal with all of this disconnect and loneliness is to actually spend time in fellowship doing kind of what the early Acts church did and kind of reprioritizing schedule around that.
So Bex, on this last one, trying to hit skepticism as a church, how are we going to face that? And, if you can summarize that for us.
Yeah, so the statement we have is that skepticism breeds doubt, but discernment builds confidence. And so discernment is actually something that the Holy Spirit gives us. It is the product of the Holy Spirit in our life. And so I would say, you know, man, the church has earned some skepticism, right? Because we are all sinful and we are all fallen human beings. And sometimes some of our big leaders like Scott just described, they fall. And so then people are left reeling with like, what do we do and who do we follow and what do we believe and who do we believe and all of this stuff. And here's what I also know to be true after 44 years of life and living in the church most of my life is this: the word of God can be trusted. The written word of God can and ought to be trusted and is our guide, but also the Holy Spirit of God that indwells us when we choose to follow Jesus is also our guide. And the Holy Spirit and the word of God will never contradict one another. So if we are feeling skeptical, if we're feeling doubtful, if we're feeling uneasy, I promise you, go to God's word, go to God's spirit and pray and ask for direction and discernment, and the Lord will show you who to believe, what to follow, which direction he wants you to go, and those things will not contradict themselves. It will also build your confidence to trust and know that God is ultimately your leader. And your pastors or people that you are listening or learning from, they ought to be surrendering and submitting their lives to God on a daily basis and following Jesus. And if they're not, stop following them.
That's great. That's perfect, man. And I love the segue here because here's the last thing. And this is the most important thing. And if hopefully in the first 3 weeks, you got this. And if you haven't, go back and listen to the first 3 weeks' messages. We have a renewed focus on what gives us the ability and the power to run in a completely different lane in this world. And that is the empowerment of the Holy Spirit. That's what you see in the book of Acts. The reason why they were able to spread the gospel globally and have such an impact in the face of persecution was not through their willpower. It wasn't through good strategy. They had both of those, but it was through the power of the Holy Spirit. As a matter of fact, Peter's talking and he's talking to some people and they're new followers of Christ. And he says, "Oh Lord, hear their hearts and give us, your servants, great boldness in preaching your word. Stretch out your hand with healing power. May miraculous signs and wonders be done through the name of your holy servants, your holy servant Jesus." After this prayer, the meeting place shook and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit. And then they preached the word of God with boldness. That's how the church operates today. And it's simply by just being empowered by the Holy Spirit. So what does that look like? How do you see, Scott, I want to be empowered by the Holy Spirit. Well, here's the first one. It starts with repentance. If you look at the message of the gospel, it always starts with repentance. Peter replied, "Each of you must repent of your sins and turn to God and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sin. Then you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit." It starts there. We have to repent and turn over to God. What's wrong in our life? What sin is there? And the good thing about that part is we don't have to be afraid of it because the grace of God is what's given to us through the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. So we don't have to be afraid of repentance. But that's where the empowerment starts. Then it moves on from there.
Yeah, it also happens in connection, that we connect with one another and we're empowered by the Spirit through our time and gathering together, as I said. So connection is a big part of it in terms of how we're open to the Holy Spirit empowering us. The third thing, which I think is a huge one, Bex talked a little bit about it, but it's to listen. It's to listen to the Holy Spirit. It's to have that discernment and wisdom. The promise is that we have access to that through the Holy Spirit. And actually, we're gonna do something right now as we head into a very important time of communion, but we're going to do some listening to the Holy Spirit right now. And for the next few moments, we're going to do some worship and do a song called The Commission. And this is a special song in terms of the commission because this is God commissioning us. This is that part of listening to what God wants for our lives, and he wants to commission us. And so what we want to do during this time is simply this, is we want to stay seated and listen to these words, and most importantly, listen to God as we head and prepare ourselves for communion. So we're just going to take a few moments right now for this song, and then we'll do the communion.
To do here before you leave. So go tell the world about me. I was dead, but now I live. I've gotta go now for a little while. And goodbye is not the end. Dead, but now I live. I've gotta go now for a little while. Goodbye is not the end. Tell the world about me. Go tell the world. For a little.
I invite you just to tear off that top layer so that you can have the bread ready. And I just have a few reminders for us today, because this is what communion is about. It's about remembering and it's about surrendering. And in your hand, you hold that cracker, and that cracker represents the broken body of Christ. But also, I want to remind you today that the church is also the body of Christ. And so through our brokenness, the world can know healing as Jesus works through our lives, because we know healing because of Jesus' broken body. And secondly, through the blood of Jesus, we know that we can have forgiveness of sins. And so as the church, we get to proclaim the good news that there is forgiveness of sins. And that reminder is for us in the cup. It says in 2 Corinthians chapter 11 that as often as we take communion together, we are proclaiming the Lord's death. And our job as the church is to go into all the world and proclaim the Lord's death and his resurrection, to share the good news of who Jesus is. So let's eat the cracker together. let's drink the cup together. God, we thank you for the gift of your son, Jesus. And Jesus, we thank you that you invite us to be your church and to be your representatives to the world around us. God, I thank you that when we leave this place, the way that we live our lives proclaims the resurrection. It proclaims the good news of who Jesus is. And so, God, I pray that you would use us in new, innovative ways to share the gospel, that we would live according to the amazing grace that we have received from you. In your name we pray, amen. Let's sing this final song together.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. Mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed.
One more thing with you. So we are going to start using the things that we just talked about, and our strategy next week is to start a brand new series called the Artificial AI. In other words, with AI and artificial intelligence, our world offers us all kinds of artificial stuff, and we're going to talk about what God offers that is not artificial, it's real thing. Now, there's a couple things about it. We're going to be playing movie clips on every week that the artificial. The first week starts out, we're playing a clip from The Matrix next week. But we're going to talk about this stuff, and I encourage you, be an invitational person. Invite someone to this series. This is a series for your unchurched friend to sit through and go, hey, let me just check this out. Bribe them if you have to. Tell them you take them to lunch afterwards, okay? Buy them in and out for a week, whatever the case is. Get them here, okay? So that we can make sure the gospel goes forward, okay? God bless you guys. Have a great day. All right, we'll see you next week.